Well, hey there, and thanks for watching this video. We are Evangel Assembly, and welcome to Church Online. My name is Asa Pray, and we are so glad that you are tuning in with us today. If you're here, we believe it is not by accident. We believe that you can meet with God right here and right now. No matter where you are or what room in life you find yourself in, we believe God is there with you and that He wants to meet with you today. If this is your first time tuning in, we would love to get connected with you. You can log on to our website, greenwall.evangelassembly.org, to fill out the I'm New card. It's really simple and easy, just some basic information. After you fill it out, someone from the church will then get in contact with you soon. Now, we're about to get started in just a few minutes, so here is a rundown for the video today. We'll start with some music, where members of our worship team will lead us in songs of honor, adoration, and connection with God. Then we'll take some time to pray together, sharing our thoughts, feelings, and needs with God. And then we'll take a brief moment where you can, if you desire, give a donation or offering to our church. After that, we'll hear a message from the Word of God that we can understand and begin to apply to our lives right away. Either our lead pastor, Pastor Brian, a staff pastor, or a guest will share the message with us today. If you are watching live with us, feel free to leave comments in the chat section on your screen. It's the best way to interact with others during the service. Moderators, pastors, and other attendees are watching with you as you participate in the service. If you'd like to know more about our church, you can visit our portal website. Go to greenwall.evangelassembly.org to get more information about us. If you want to get in contact with us, you can browse through our calendar, or you can even share a prayer request with us. Either way, this is the place to go. Check out greenwall.evangelassembly.org for all the information about our church. Feel free to participate in this service however you feel comfortable. If you're new, or this video just popped up on your feed, then don't worry about it. Just sit back, relax, and watch. If you've done this before, then feel free to actively join in with us. You're welcome to sing along, to pray with us, or even grab a Bible, get some pen and paper out, and maybe take some notes. But in the end, we believe God wants to meet with you and speak to you today. And we believe that He can change your life forever. We're so glad that you were here, and we hope that you were blessed by our service today. So thank you so much for watching, and enjoy the service.
Just gone through the motions. I'm sorry when I sang another song. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. And I'm sorry when I've come my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough. Take me back to where we started. I'll open up my heart to you. Nothing else, cause nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you, and nothing else, cause nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you. There's nothing else, and nothing else, cause nothing else will do. I just want you, and nothing else, oh, nothing else, and nothing else will do. Give us clean hands and give us pure hearts, and let us not lift our souls to another. So give us clean hands and give us pure hearts, and let us not lift our souls to another. So give us clean hands and give us pure hearts, and let us not lift our souls to another. So give us clean hands and give us pure hearts, let us not lift our souls to another. So God, let us be a generation that seeks your face, O God of Jacob. And O God, let us be a generation that seeks your face, O God of Jacob. Give us clean hands and give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. So give us clean hands and give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. And oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face, oh God of Jacob. And oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face, oh God. Oh God, let us be a generation. Change us, Lord, seek your face. Change us, Lord Jesus. Oh, let us be a generation that seeks your face, oh God.
The praise is yours.
and the praise is yours. You're the one we bow before, reigning over us as we lift you up. You will reign forevermore, and the praise is yours, and the praise is yours. You're the one we bow before, reigning over us as we lift you up. You will reign forevermore. Glory and praise, power and strength, worthy is the Lamb of God, hallelujah. Glory and praise, power and strength, worthy is the Lamb of God, hallelujah. Glory and praise, power and strength, worthy is the Lamb of God, hallelujah. Glory and praise, hallelujah. Worthy is the Lamb of God, hallelujah.
So worthy, Jesus.
And the praise is yours, and the praise is yours. You're the one we bow before, reigning over us as we lift you up. You will reign
Church news.
Are you still coming to church but haven't taken the plunge to become a member?
Well,
that's like standing out here instead of going into the sanctuary. Dave does that too. You know what else Dave does?
When the moon hits your eye like a big pizza pie, that's amore. When the world seems to shine like you've had too much wine, that's amore. Bells will ring, ting-a-ling-a-ling, ting-a-ling-a-ling, and you'll sing Vita Bella. Hearts will play tippy-tippy-tay, tippy-tippy-tay, like a guitarandella. When the stars make you drool, just like a pastifazool, that's amore. When you dance down the street with a cloud at your feet, you're in love. When you walk in a dream.
Don't be like Dave. Join the church.
When the moon hits your eye like a bigger pizza pie, that's...
Now that's some good news.
Hey, everybody. Hey, you know, one of the features of modern life is we're constantly bombarded with the threat of cyber attacks. You know, whether it's hackers trying to gain access to highly sensitive data or whether it's our social media accounts that have been hacked. In fact, if you've been hacked in some way in a social media account in the past, put in the chat, me too, because I could put myself in there. I just got noticed that my LinkedIn account was hacked last week, and they sent me like a notice that I needed to change my password because they had a data breach. Wait, did you know you could actually rent ransomware programs that are made in Russia, and you can use them to hold people hostage till they pay up? Honestly, it's so bad today with this. If you read it in the news, companies actually do pay up. Like the pipeline interruption earlier this year, if you remember it. Meatpacking companies, municipalities, hospitals have all been hit by these ransomware attacks. It's becoming more and more common. And people begin to wonder, well, what if they shut down the power grid one day? You know, and hold on till somebody pays them. But there might be a bigger threat to shutting down America's power grid than that. It's a sneaky, small, homegrown threat. You know what it is? Squirrels. Squirrels actually have successfully attacked America's power grid systems. Are you ready for this? 623 times, compared to the few times outside hackers have done so. So the score is squirrels 323 to outside attackers, two or three. As the story says I was reading this in, the real cyber enemy lives inside, a true insider threat, and has been attacking national power lines for decades. Squirrels. Look, small things can make a big difference, for harm or for good. And in the series that we're in, we've started talking about taking a journey in our life with Jesus. And I know when I say that, some of you think, oh, I've done that. You know, lived that, done that, got the t-shirt, you know, got that down. But I'm actually here to tell you today that there's more than you know. There really is. And my prayer is that God will open all of our eyes as to the more that he has for us. Now, we're going to look at what it means in the series to really follow Jesus. And we're going to use this definition of a disciple to guide us. Someone who is following Jesus, being changed by Jesus, and who is committed with others to the mission of Jesus. So when we started using this definition, first week we started at the beginning looking at the question, who are you following? Are you following yourself? Are you following others and their opinions and what they think you should do? Or are you following Jesus? Well, last week we moved on to the next part of the definition, that a disciple is someone who's being changed by Jesus. And we asked the question, are we being changed or shortchanged in our experience in our spiritual life? And we said that week that the goal of discipleship is to become like Jesus himself, to think as he thought, to feel as he felt, to act as he acted, and to desire what he desired. Look, if anything else is happening in your life, you've been shortchanged in your discipleship. Well, today we look at a very small but important part of the definition, the with others part. That a disciple is someone who is following Jesus, being changed by Jesus, and who is committed with others to the mission of Jesus. Truth is, spiritual transformation takes place in our life incrementally, over time, with others, in the context of the disciplines and practices that open us up to God. Robert Mulholland wrote this, "We can no more be transformed to the image of Christ outside corporate spirituality than a coal can continue to burn outside of the fire." Look, some of you are trying to be that coal, doing it on your own, and you're wondering why your faith is not red hot. Well, the reason is you were never meant to take this spiritual journey alone. And the good news is you don't have to. We have all kinds of groups at Evangel that can help you, even at the level where you join us on YouVersion and we chat on the Bible, the verses we're reading each week that match Sunday's theme, on the level of small groups, online and in person, and even on the level of very small groups or micro groups of three or four people, each meant to help you not be alone. Look, so many of our core values as a church tie in right in this part. Like every 10 years or so, we relook at what we're here to do at Evangel. And we started that look, the last one, just before COVID. And we returned back to it this summer to finish up the work. And pastoral staff members and board members and church members of various ages and ethnicities and experiences were involved in this process. And we really purposed to listen to God for this season and ask, what does God have for us here, right now? You're going to hear more about our conclusions soon at church. But so many of our core values line up with this topic today. For one thing, we value as a church authentic spirituality, that we value leading people to connect with God in authentic and life-changing ways. Look, this is a big reason behind our present discipleship push. We want to help you connect to God in real, powerful ways. We believe spiritual transformation takes place incrementally, over time, with others, in the context of the disciplines and practices that open us up to God. Another one of our core values as a church that this team came up with is purposeful action, that we value providing purposeful opportunities for people to become all God has called them to become. This is why we're intentional about what we're offering right now in our small groups, in our microgroups, and whether it's online or in person or through your version. Another thing that we value is relational value, that we value personally connecting and caring for others wherever they might be in life. Look, you can't get where God wants you to be without connection with others. You just can't do it. And we want to help you with that. So here's the question I'm going to ask you today. Who are you traveling with and for in your journey with Jesus? I want to look at one verse from the Bible that lays out the importance of the with others part of our disciple definition. Though one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves, and a cord of three strands is not quickly broken. That's Ecclesiastes 4:12. I really like what Clarence Hayes wrote about this. Now, he has girls, and I've only had boys, so he can explain this so much better than me. This is what he wrote. Every once in a while, my wife will go through the task of braiding our daughter's hair, something I, by the way, have never had to do. You should see the back and forth drama that they sometimes go through to get this done. In the braiding, she's intertwining the hair, keeping it together. However, over time, the braids have to be undone to wash the hair or whatever level of maintenance is needed. Well, when it comes time to undo the braids, that's where the real fun, he writes, begins. Over time, the braids have become stronger, and it's difficult, really difficult, to undo them. But if you've ever undone braids, then you're probably shaking your head right now. This is an example of how a cord of three strands works. It's simply a cord of three strands that becomes braided or intertwined together. And this type of cord is very difficult to break. It doesn't mean it can't be broken. It just means it's harder to do. So to understand this one verse, let's back up a little bit. And I want to look at the full thought in Ecclesiastes. Two are better than one because they have good reward for their efforts. For if either falls, his companion can lift him up. But pity the one who falls without another to lift him up. Also, if two lie down together, they can keep warm. But how can one person alone keep warm? And if someone overpowers one person, two can resist him. A cord of three strands is not easily broken. That's from the Christian Standard Bible. Well, when you read the full thought here, you quickly discover that Solomon is talking about the power of relationships. One of the most important things this passage of Scripture wants you to know is that all of us need each other. Look, after God created Adam in the Genesis story, he said words that were true then and are true to this day. The Lord God said, "It is not good for the man to be alone." Look, many times this gets applied in a marital sense, but this is true whether you're married or not. It's not good for you to do life alone. The idea of a lone wolf or a person who thinks they don't need anyone is not only bad for the individual, it's actually foreign to God's design for humanity. We need each other. He made us this way. I need you, just as much as you need me. We were created for fellowship. Now, this includes fellowship with God, but also with others. Now, Satan knows the first step to destroy us is to isolate us. So I want you to look at this cord we talked about from Scripture from a different perspective for a moment. I want to use the three-strand cord as an analogy for the three cords you should consider in your life. And they're the three cords you will get in a discipleship small group or a micro group or a small group that you're a part of. That's why you need to be in one. I believe if you have these three, you will build in your life something that's not easily broken. Now, to do this, let's look at some of the verses from Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verses 9 through 12. Let's look at first the cord of accountability. For if either falls, his companion can lift him up, but pity the one who falls without another to lift him up. That's verse 10. Look, one of the cords you must have in your life is accountability. There must be people in your life that you can be open and honest with. There must be someone in your life that you will allow to correct and rebuke and encourage and motivate you to be all that God has called you to be. The reason why so many people fall or fall away even from the faith is because they have no one they can be accountable to. Again, this falls into the trap of being alone. Part of the whole accountability bit is to prevent you from falling. But if you should fall, isn't it great to know that there's someone there ready to lift you up and restore you? The Bible says, brothers and sisters, if someone is caught in a sin, you who live by the Spirit should restore that person gently. But watch yourselves, or you also may be tempted. That's Galatians 6:1. This is accountability in action. Look, each week in the groups that we do, we share about when we were close to God, when we were far away from God. When did we do well by God's grace, and when did we not do so well? I want you to listen to how the cord of accountability has helped.
Hey, everybody. Hey, I just want to welcome Ashley Reardon with us today and Bill McCloskey, and we're going to just talk about kind of following Jesus together with other people and like how that makes a difference. You know, I know a lot of people think, well, I can just do this following Jesus thing alone. Like, I can do it. It's just me and Jesus, and we're going to plow through and everything like that. But, you know, it's kind of interesting, because I actually think when you read the New Testament, God meant for us to do this together. You know, he sent the disciples out two by two. Paul was always traveling with other people. Just read his epistles. He's always talking about who's with him. We were never meant to do this thing alone. And there's reasons why that's a good thing. I know we resist that, but it's a good thing. And one of the good things is accountability. And I know people think, oh, accountability, that's such a nasty, scary, negative word. But it's really not. It just means like there's other people that can help us like do what we've always wanted to do. And they can support us, encourage us in moving forward. So I just wanted to chat about that today. So, Bill or Ashley, what do you see as the benefits of having that accountability as you try to, you know, walk with Jesus?
Well, for me, the accountability was helpful in a couple of different ways. Number one, obviously, we all have things that we do want to do, as you said, and sometimes it's easy to procrastinate those things. But for me, it never felt like accountability on my journey with my brothers over the last several weeks or several months, actually. It felt more like camaraderie, where we have this tight bond and we're holding each other up and supporting one another and we're taking this walk together. And to me, it felt like I didn't want to let them down, not that I had to do things, but because I really wanted to do things, and probably because I wanted to do those things to begin with, but now because of the camaraderie and the brotherhood of meeting together and that unity, it gave me one more reason to do those things and do them joyfully.
Hmm. Yeah, that's awesome. I love that image of camaraderie. And I like what you said, like, you didn't do it because you had to, because that feels like legalism, right? But you wanted to, you know, and that makes all the difference. That makes all the difference. So Ashley, of course, everybody, she's our pastor over discipleship. So what do you think about this whole thing of accountability and as we, you know, taking this journey together with others?
I think it's important. I mean, you look at Jesus, he had his people and he talked to them like, how are you doing? What are you doing? And it's just that that extra push we sometimes need. Like Bill said, there's things that we want to do, and maybe we are struggling with motivation or the right motivation. You know, we were going at it from a different point of view and maybe a selfish motivation, where when you have people walking alongside of you, going through a lot of the same things or at that same juncture in your discipleship, they can say, oh, I've been there and I've struggled with that too. Here's a suggestion. Or, you know what, Ashley, you've said that 3 weeks in a row. How can we change this for you? And they just give me that little nudge, and I don't recognize I said the same thing 3 weeks in a row.
Wow.
But they are able to bring it to the light and say, you're struggling with that. I don't know if you realize it, but how can we help you? And that's a huge thing to hear.
Yeah, that's really awesome. I like that. And there's such a value in people listening to us too, right? And being heard. And I think that's one of the things too, because our discipleship groups are these safe places, right, where you can share anything, and you're not going to hear it in the hallways of the church, like right the next week. But like, and there's such a cool thing that happens in that. What would either one of you guys say about like if people are thinking, I'm afraid of like connecting with other people, you know, to take that journey. I just want to keep it to myself, and like, especially like they're scared of that whole accountability and even that word. What would be something you'd say to them about that?
For myself personally, I would just say you really don't know what you're missing until you dive in. It's a much deeper walk when you're doing it with your brothers and sisters, and it deepens your relationship with Jesus, but it deepens your relationship here with your brothers and sisters as well. And for me, that deeper walk provided a much deeper sense of peace. And we all need that, because life has potholes, as we know. And having that foundation already there when those potholes sneak up on us is key. And it's certainly a lot stronger when you're building that foundation and doing that walk with your brothers and sisters.
Yeah, absolutely. Ashley, any final words for us about this?
I would just say, don't let your fear hold you back. I mean, the basis of the discipleship groups is loving others and loving Jesus. So once you get that foundation, it's not a condemnation accountability. It's this loving, growing conviction that the Holy Spirit uses to help us grow to the place he wants us to be.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know what else I found is like, once people take that step to dive in, like we're all leading a different group, you know, now. And so I know my guys, they all said like, I was waiting for this. Like there is this, like, you know, they knew they needed this and didn't even know how much they needed it. And it's just been, it's been nothing but a blessing to have that with each other. I know they would say the same thing. So hey, thanks for talking about this, especially in accountability today, and just how that helps us in following Jesus together. So thanks, you guys. Thank you for your time. Let's talk about the next chord, the chord of unity. The Bible says also, if two lie down together, they can keep warm, but how can one person keep warm alone? That's Ecclesiastes 4:11. The word I want you to focus on in this verse is the word together. Look, this is the heartbeat of unity. Notice that Solomon says that one of the benefits of being together is warmth. If you apply this to your relationship with Jesus, one of the ways we keep God's love burning in our hearts is by encouraging and inspiring one another. This type of love is contagious, and this kind of love grows when you're united with other believers who love Jesus. And as you connect with other believers who love God as much as you do, it'll keep the warm fire of God's love, you know, in your heart burning. Look, you can't be a red hot coal apart from the fire. You can't. Let's listen to how this works in this panel discussion. So we want to talk about, like, again, this following Jesus with others, and especially talking about the importance of unity. How that's so important. You know, I think we've all heard that statement, you know, united we stand, divided we fall. And how true is that? And I think one of Satan's tactics is actually to get us to feel absolutely alone and isolated, that we're the only ones going through something. We're the only ones facing this. We're the only ones who've ever struggled with doubt or fear in this area. And then comes the condemnation, and then comes the, you know, pity party, or then comes the whatever tactic he wants to use to like keep us in that place. But one of the cool things about taking a journey together with others with Jesus is that your brothers and sisters can help you fight that, that you're not alone, that you're not the only one that feels that way, that you're not the only one going through it. And that's just just amazingly powerful to know that. So I just wanted to chat with Ashley and Bill again about that, and just, you know, the unity that comes when you're a part of following Jesus with others. So yeah, let's chat about that. Bill, you were talking about just an insight from scripture you had just as we were thinking about this. Why don't you go ahead and share that?
When we're thinking about discipleship and unity, I had the thought of the disciples after Jesus was crucified, and they gathered together and had, in my mind, an incomprehensible level of fear. But they gathered together, and I'm sure there was comfort in that unity. I can't even imagine if they all dispersed and were all by themselves at that tremendously impossible time in their lives. So the unity piece obviously has been taught to us from the beginning, and I think it's kind of a natural part of our human makeup is to be together and find that strength in one another. As I mentioned to you recently, there's a reason there's support groups for virtually every challenging topic or life's challenges out there, and it's because we aren't supposed to do this stuff alone. Other people are going through the same challenges we are, and we can find strength and support from one another. So I think that unity is pretty evident.
Absolutely. And we're just so much better equipped for the battle when we're, you know, together, and we're all in a battle. That's the thing. Like, again, I think Satan wants us to think we're the only ones in the battle, and then he condemning us that we shouldn't even be in a battle. You know, it should be, you know, and you know, imagine that, like you said, the disciples in that situation, and there's so many people out there today that live in that kind of place of fear or doubt or uncertainty, and they're doing it alone. And that's just, it doesn't have to be that way. And Jesus did not want us to do it that way. So Ashley, what do you think about this benefit?
I mean, it can go in so many different areas of our life that you need people. And like you said, we were built for community. So we're built for unity. I mean, we can have a community that's divided, but God wants us to be united. And I mean, it helps us in all aspects. When you think of growth, I mean, just this morning, Bill and I had a conversation over the phone talking about something that we're both going into in our groups, and being able to have a conversation about that and being unified where we're at in our groups helps us to walk through these things and say, I don't really understand this. I have a question about this. And then I shot off a message to the rest of our group saying, hey, you know what? I have a question about this. And there's joy in being able to say, hey, I have a question, and knowing that there's other people that have been there and have maybe those same questions and are now walking through that, or been there, done that, and came out of it, and they can help guide me.
Yeah. And there's a strength in that unity, right? Because someone else might be able to give something that helps you in that moment to help others, and all these kind of things, which is really, really, really so powerful, so cool to see that happen. It's just awesome. And I really grieve when I watch people go through things like alone, the battles, the difficulties, because they don't have to. They don't have to do that. That's not what Jesus intended. And I know they're afraid of that walking with others, you know, and I think that's part of, again, Satan's plan. He builds up that fear in our mind. But when you get together with others, you realize, look, we're all just flesh and blood. We all have, you know, problems. And all I've ever seen in the discipleship groups I've led, when someone talks about something they're going through as a struggle, is everyone else doesn't condemn them. They rally around them, right, to pray for them and support them. And all I've ever seen is the strength of that unity. And I just think every time that happens, I'm like, man, I wish every Christian knew what it was like to have that support, right? What a difference that would make in their life. And I think that's why Jesus designed us to do this together. So any final thoughts about this that you guys have?
No, I think one final thought, I guess, Ashley, kind of hit the nail on the head. I never realized the word unity is in the word community.
That's right.
I don't think there's a coincidence there, right?
No, there's not. That's great. In fact, Ashley, I was thinking about it because you and I had a conversation about, even in women's ministry, like you have the big, you know, conference events, and we often think, oh, that's the service or the big thing that makes the difference. But you had said, you know what, really, like, it's that small group community that actually makes the difference.
It really does. When you walk through the things that you're learning together and you learn to apply them together and you wrestle with those things together, that's when you're going to grow and you're going to actually succeed in it. If you try it alone, any little trip up, you're just going to walk away. It goes back to the accountability piece. Like, you need that unity and community to help you go along.
Yeah, and we do. And we need, while we need the large group inspiration, let's say of Sunday morning, we also need that other, like, a few people that know me and my life and can support me and care about me. You know, that's why in Acts you read that they met in the temple courts, but also from house to house. It wasn't like an either or, well, I'm going to go to church Sunday or I'm going to do like a small group. It was like, no, I need both those things because they both touch us in different ways. So
next, I want to talk about the court of resistance. The Bible says if someone overpowers one person, two can resist him. That's Ecclesiastes 4:12. If you go through this Christian journey, you will face challenges. And not only will they come externally from Satan, they will also come internally from your own sinful nature. And to fight against these two enemies, you must at times resist. And let's face it, sometimes we get tired. Like, my grandfather was a Golden Gloves champ in boxing. And there's an expression in boxing that says, fatigue makes cowards of us all. When you get tired, you become vulnerable. And this is where the body of Christ comes into play. When you're tired and at the point of being overpowered, your brother or sister in Christ can step in and help you stand strong. It's amazing how your courage and boldness can increase when you're not standing by yourself. Let's watch how this happens as we go back to that panel discussion again.
Well, welcome back, everybody. And so we're going to talk again about the value of following Jesus with others, but talk about it from the lens of like having strength for the battle. You know, it's kind of interesting that this passage in Ecclesiastes actually talks about it in that regard specifically, that one, standing alone, is easily defeated, two can fight back to back, and three, like, people like has that strength that can't be broken. And so, you know, it actually, this concept of like walking with others right here in this book is all about the fact that, hey, everybody, we're in a battle. Like, everybody's in a battle. And we kind of have this choice. Do you want to fight it alone or do you want to fight it with others? And what difference it makes in our life when we have others with us. And what a strength that comes, what a reassurance that comes to us in that battle. So we want to talk about that and the importance of that. And Bill was actually talking about an example from his life, like that, what a difference, you know, walking with others made in his life and how he reacted to circumstances of life. Because sometimes the battle isn't someone coming at you with a sword. Sometimes it's just like something unexpected in life happens. And how do we respond to it? And it makes a difference when we've been walking with others. So, Bill, if you share that story, I think it's a good one.
Sure, absolutely. So through my walk, absolutely, with my brothers, it does strengthen us. But for me, one of the ways it strengthened me was just to give me a much deeper level of peace. And it's a deeper level of peace that you're not even really conscious of, but until you need it.
And, right.
Just a few weeks ago, one of my key people decided or was given a career opportunity with another company and gave his 2-week notice, literally 2 weeks before the busiest time of the year.
Yeah.
He's booked to do something like 35 workshops and 200 or 300 individual appointments. And now that's all falling either on me or another member of the team. But the point is, my first response was, it's going to be okay. And I just had this deep inner peace. And I can guarantee you, a year ago, my initial response would have been drastically different. And my second response was, I'm going to pray for him and his family because I hope this is beneficial for him and I hope this is a positive move for him. And I really didn't have any concerns about myself and my team and my personal life or the burden he threw on us, not intentionally, but it's just something that happened. That whole situation didn't become a problem. I think it's that foundation of peace that that the walk with my brothers over the last several months has provided.
That's awesome. And even thinking about it, like even that image in Ecclesiastes, there's even peace in the battle because you know you're not fighting it alone, right? You're not in it alone. And so not only is Jesus with you, which that's the most important piece, right? But like there's others that have been there. That's awesome. You know what? Yeah. I love that because it's such a real life practical illustration. You know, does it make a difference that we walk with Jesus with others? Yes, it does.
Yes, it does. Yes,
yes, it does. Yes, it
all
does.
All day, every day.
That's right. It makes a difference. So, Ashley, what do you think about this? What are your thoughts?
I mean, same thing, like along those lines of it's so beneficial. And sometimes we don't realize the benefits or we overlook them. I know when we went through our discipleship group this past year, there were big things that a lot of, I think all three of us women went through, and we just held each other before God. And scripture tells us to pray for one another, carry each other's burdens. And I know that there were things that I wouldn't have been able to get through alone. But knowing I can text my family, they were my family, my sisters, and saying, hey, you know what, I'm struggling with this. And they can say, you know what, we're praying for you. Or they knew I was struggling and they were checking in and how can we help you? And I mean, we brought meals to each other. We did so much to support and love one another that's the only way we literally got through these things that we were facing.
Yeah. And you know what's so cool watching that happen? It all happened organically, didn't it? You know, it was natural. It was real life. You wanted to support each other because you've been in relationship and you cared about each other. It was so authentic. You know, it was so much that image of what the body of Christ is supposed to be like. When one suffers, we all suffer. When one rejoices, we all rejoice. And, you know, that only happens when we connect with other people to the place that we're known and we know them, right? When they're just someone that, like, well, we happen to go to the same church and face the same direction, you know, for an hour and a half or an hour and a quarter on a Sunday, it doesn't really happen in that context. I mean, that's a good context for certain other things, you know, like worship and teaching, but like that connection with each other that helps us in the battle, man, that needs to happen in small settings.
Mm-hmm, absolutely.
And I know you believe that because, like, you're overseeing our small group ministry. So it's so important that people do that. Yeah. Any final thoughts about this topic?
When you have the opportunity, take it, join a group so that you have those people alongside of you. I mean, when you look at scripture and we read like putting on the whole armor of God, like we're supposed to do that. But there are times where I don't have a helmet, but somebody has a helmet and they're next to me and they can share that with me. They can really come alongside and protect me from things that I need help with.
Yeah. That's awesome. And then there's times we can do that for others. And that feels good too, doesn't it? Like
such a blessing.
Like when we can actually support someone else and pray for someone else. And that's not just something that we pastors get to do. Like everybody can have that privilege. Just a couple of weeks ago, I was talking to someone who talked about like how I had walked with them through a situation. And they literally said, I don't think I could have made it through this. And they were being very literal. You know, unless I had someone to walk with. And it was just one of these humbling moments where afterward, you just like, God, thank you so much that you can, you know, use me. I don't know how you do it. It has to be you, but you can use me to help someone like that. But that's something that all of us can do. It's not just, oh, you got to be a pastor to do that. Like we can all make that difference in someone else's life. So we get and we give. It's just an awesome thing. So any final thoughts, Bill?
No, I just say to everybody, let you become us, you know, join a team and let's keep growing together.
Amen. And there's some ways I really believe that we only grow when we grow together, you know, that we're really stunting our growth when we don't do it together. And so, hey, thanks you guys for your time. It's been great to have this chat with you guys today. Thanks for taking time to do this.
Remember, it all goes back to the fact that you and I were not created to be alone. When you consider the impact of this three-stranded cord in your life, I think that two things happen. You can do more, and you can be more. Think about Ecclesiastes 4:9. Two are better than one because they have a good reward for their efforts. You know, ultimately, the beauty of a three-stranded cord is that it makes you stronger. I mean, God knew this from the beginning, and there are plenty of scriptures throughout the Bible that support this truth. Now, with this in mind, I want to ask you a question. Who are you connected to? Who are you making the journey to follow Jesus with? Look, this will make you stronger. It'll make you more accountable. It'll make you more productive. So I want to ask you again, who are you connected to? It's essential that you get connected to others in the body of Christ. Now, don't let the idea that this connection with others won't be perfect stop you from joining in. People are not perfect. You are not perfect too. But just because it won't be perfect doesn't mean it won't be wonderful and good and needful. Don't let the dream of Christian community as you think it should be destroy real Christian community, which can be messy and challenging sometimes. But sometimes the messy is how we grow best. Don't opt out because it's not perfect. The immature Christian runs from place to place to place looking for perfect community, not realizing, it doesn't exist. Especially as soon as they walk through the door, it doesn't exist anymore. But just because it's not perfect doesn't mean it can't be wonderful. When it gets tough to be in connection with others because they rub you the wrong way, you may be tempted to say, well, I don't need this, I don't need them. But you actually do. God uses the pains of life, even in church relationships, to fuel our formation in Christ. We are a community of broken sinners, broken people in the process of being made fit for heaven. Also, this connection won't just benefit you, it'll also benefit those you're connected with. Sometimes you'll be the cord that needs to be lifted up, but sometimes you'll be the cord that needs to be there to lift others up. Christian community and connection in the end never is really about us or for us anyway. It's about what God will do in us and through us as there is an us. Regardless of the role that you will play, and they will change at times, just being a part of that three-stranded cord means you will not be easily broken, and you will help others to not be easily broken. Look, you and I were never meant to be alone. A disciple is someone who is following Jesus, being changed by Jesus, and is committed with others to the mission of Jesus. I hope you're joining us in this journey. Someone wrote this as a review on our church's Facebook page just a few weeks ago. They said, quote, "It's a beautiful group of people walking together to find Christ," end quote. I love it. I hope you will walk with us too. And together we will find Christ and allow Christ to be formed in us in ways that can't happen when we walk alone. So who are you connected with? And if you're not, what's your step to make that connection? We'd be glad to help. Really, we want to walk with you. Don't walk alone. Be a part of that three-branded cord that cannot easily be broken. God bless you guys. Have a great day. And please, let us walk with you as you walk with Jesus.
Thank you for tuning in today. We hope that you are a little bit closer to God than when you started watching. If you want to know more about us or get connected to our church, just log on to the Green Wall website. If you are new and this service blessed you, let us know by filling out the I'm New card listed on the website, and we'll get back to you soon. If you are a regular attendee and would like to get in touch, just fill out the Contact Us card, give us your name and information, and we'll get connected with you soon. And thank you so much for being here, and let's take the time to close in a word of prayer. Father God, I thank you for each person that's watching, Lord. I thank you that this video found them online. I thank you that they had a chance to hear and watch and see. Lord God, I pray that they will remember and know that you are always with them and for them. I pray they will feel a sense of your love and your hope and your joy right now in this moment. No matter what's going on in their life, Lord God, you are with them always. I pray that they will see that and know that and feel that throughout the rest of their week. May you lead them and guide them and bless them. And may they begin today to put a little bit more trust in you. Thank you for this opportunity. May you bless those that are watching, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hey, thank you so much for being here with us today. If you really enjoyed the video, go ahead and hit like, hit the thumbs up button, or go ahead and subscribe so we can keep giving you these videos. We're glad that you've been here with us today. Thank you so much. Hope to see you soon. God bless you, and have a great day.